But we're having lots and lots of these conversations all over the five counties of this district. And it's because of all of you that we're going to win in November. So thank you very, very much. I appreciate it. And I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Yeah.
Anybody has any questions, thoughts?
I call them the two Toms, Tom Reed and Tom America. Are spending a lot of time going around the district, not at things like this. They're usually in a BFW mall or somewhere. How are you going to be able to get yourself in the same room with Tom America to argue the points that you're arguing here? But I'd like to see the two of you debating.
Well, I'm going to need you to ask over and over. I'm going to need everyone to say, we want to see a debate. Because really, there's no value to Tom O'Mara in debating me. And we've seen that already. Since I announced my campaign in January, he's been really kind of off the radar. He hasn't had much to say about me at all, which is, you know, the strategy that he has employed. I'm very grateful. Every single morning, I get to get up and meet with another group of people and get my message out there without feedback from him. But he has decided that ignoring me is the way to go. And he's going to continue that, I suspect. And so it will take a lot of energy and protest to get him to show up at a debate. What he is doing is he is all of a sudden, out of nowhere, working harder than he has in his 16 years in Albany. And I do say to people, and I'm not entirely joking, take one of those stickers that you've got and go into Mr. O'Mara's office and ask for whatever your project is, that pothole that hasn't been filled for decades, that school that never gets funded, that social services program that is struggling just to survive. Go in and talk with him about it and stick your sticker on, because the getting's really good right now. There is pork coming into this district in order to make it look like he's doing stuff at a very rapid clip. And those of us on my campaign, we kind of pride ourselves on it. We say, look at how much money we're bringing into the district already. I mean, it's kind of exciting.
Well, we want bandwidth.
We need broadband. We need broadband, and the communication workers have endorsed me. And I think probably most of you know that the Verizon employees are on strike right now. And I am standing on the picket lines with them, because that is not just about Verizon workers and their salaries and their ability to be with their families. Verizon sends workers away for 21 days at a time, and now wants to be able to send them away for 60 days away from their families. That causes great disruption in the community for people to be pushed away like that. It's not, for me, it's not just about that, though. It's also about those children who are in my daughter's fifth grade class, who come home from school every day with their Chromebooks. Every fifth grader in my daughter's class gets a Chromebook. They come home from school to their Chromebooks, and their houses, their mobile homes, perhaps don't have internet access. And so those children are not able to do their homework. Verizon is very purposefully not building broadband out because it doesn't benefit their bottom line. We have to stand up to that, and we have to say to our leaders, look, if Verizon is going to be making millions of dollars in our community, then it needs to build out last mile internet, because those are children we're talking about. That's our future. And I'm standing up for that. They're holding businesses back. People can't apply for jobs. Small businesses have a very hard time, maintaining their internet service. It's a very purposeful decision that rural internet is not profitable, and they don't want to do it. But if they're going to get the kind of tax breaks and the kind of subsidies that they get for being in New York State, getting businesses in New York State, then they've got to serve the whole state. So go see Tom O'Mara and ask him what he thinks about rural broadband. Uh, he, had a lot to say about rural broadband a couple of years ago, but I haven't seen him actually stand up and do anything. So I'll just wrap up by saying that this is a winnable race. This can be done. This is not pie in the sky. This district is 5 counties large. Yeah. It includes hundreds of thousands of people. And they vote. They may not vote as often as we want them to, but they do, they vote. And when they vote for Democratic candidates. Barack Obama carried this district in 2012. There's 33% Democrats in this district. He carried it at 52%. And that's when he was running against Mitt Romney, who in the current lineup of presidential Republican candidates looks like, you know, flaming liberal. Kirsten Gillibrand carried this district at 63% in 2012. Hillary Clinton. And she's what?
She's poor farms.
And
you're in the poorest community in this district. Tyler County is poor.
It's
a hard time. Tax burden is high. I live on the lake. Our tax burden is high. Job opportunity is low. It's an ag.
It's an ag economy.
It really is. It's
and Kirsten has farms, and
she did.
And Hillary Clinton got
she
farms
did.
Too. She was
did.
Our
so what's center. Your proposal for creating jobs or helping us ag businesses that struggle? It's really farming.
It's one of my top priorities.
And we pay the most in taxes.
It's really true.
And
there aren't incentives
for farmers.
There aren't incentives out there for farmers to do the right thing, right? I mean, farmers don't get, we were just talking about this, that it's much harder for farms to qualify for example, solar tax credits. It's much harder for farms to apply for, you know, subsidies that come in for health insurance for their workers.
Exactly.
Just the way the tax code is set up, farms are slotted off in this whole separate section
we need
of
a
business.
Voice.
And you need a voice. You do. You need an ag voice. And I gotta tell you, I'm with you 100%.
You're sitting here in ag, the heart of the ag community in New York State. I mean, you're in the heart of it. And we pay a lot of taxes. This winery pays a lot of taxes.
I know. And I don't see those dollars coming back. I'll just give you one more example of the high taxes and how they're not coming back on infrastructure development. So, you know, we've got crumbling culverts, we've got roads
exactly.
that have potholes, we've got bridges.
And I live on a lake and I get nothing for my tax dollars. Absolutely nothing.
It's terrible. There was a tax added to the gas tax in 2009. All of our taxes at the pump went up a few cents in 2009. And the agreement in the legislature was they were going to impose this gas tax and it was going to go into a special fund. It was going to be called the Bridge and Highway Trust Fund. And that fund was going to be used to rehabilitate upstate infrastructure, bridges, roads, culverts, the whole nine. Every single year since then, there has been a vote to take the money out of the Bridge and Highway Trust Fund and instead send it to capital projects in New York City. So every single year that Tom O'Meara has voted for the transportation bill, he has voted to take our dollars that were promised to us and send them downstate instead. I gotta tell you, downstate politicians don't just live in New York City. Sometimes they live in Chemungtown. This year, the amount of money that got transferred was $8.3 billion, with a B, was transferred in November out of the Bridge and Highway Trust Fund downstate. Now, I'm sure that there's infrastructure needs downstate. I'm sure there are, because they're all over the state. But my question is, why take those dollars that were promised to us through the gas tax and reroute them? Until I see every single pothole filled out there, I will not be on board with sending our money downstate. It's a real problem. At the same time as this $8.3 billion got transferred, we were all glorying in the fact that we had just gotten the $500 million, 1/16th the amount, for the Upstate Revitalization Initiative, you know, this Hunger Games program where we won $500 million. $500 million is a lot of money. That's a lot more money than I'm ever going to see in my lifetime. But it's a drop in the bucket compared to the dollars that are flowing out of here elsewhere. We deserve a place.
We do. We're tourism driven. And we collect so much money in tourism dollars.
Yeah.
This county alone sees millions of people, and we bring in a lot of money in tax dollars. Why isn't that coming back to our community? Not only that, but we have up at the near the racetrack at 414, we have an industrial park, and we would like to see some funding to help build light industry to come up there and bring jobs in.
And why does New York City send all their garbage upstate?
Well, yeah, that's another question.
It's disgusting.
I know, it's terrible.
But even still, in New York City, we have two of the worst airports in the country that come in here. We have like two of the worst, John F. Kennedy and LaGuardia, are two of the worst airports. So this money, this transportation money that's supposed to be fixing those, that's still not happening.
It's not doing that either. Yeah, you're exactly right. It's just basic math. If we're paying this much in property taxes and we're getting this back, they don't even out. Where is that money going? I'm asking that question over and over. There's a black box in Albany that the money goes through, and somehow when it comes out, it's about a tenth of what went in. Where is that money going? Mr. O'Meara's been there for 16 years. He must know. And I'm asking over and over. It's his job.
Are there many other upstate seats open for the summer?
There, well, this one's not open.
Well,
I'm running against really interesting comment, but yes, there are a few other challenge races that are happening, and most of us who are running on good government platforms, and we're running to talk about this. Todd Kaminsky, he's not upstate, he's on Long Island, but he just won a very, very tight race, special election for Dean Scalise's seat, because Dean Scalise is going to jail, and so his seat's open. And Todd won talking about good government and talking about corruption and lobbying and how it's costing all of us a lot of money. This message resonates, and I don't have any illusions that I, as one lonely state senator from, you know, the five counties of the Southern Tier and Finger Lakes, can change this single-handedly. First of all, I'm going to need all of you to participate and raise your voices with me. And second of all, I'm going to need to see other voices talking about this across the state. Fortunately for us, there are other voices talking about this. The U.S. attorney is indicting and convicting people right and left. That's one thing. And then candidates are running on platforms that really challenge this and really say, look, this is expensive. Corruption is very expensive, and we can't afford it anymore.
Can't just wait for all of them to die. Or be put in jail.
We can't just wait for all of them to be put in jail. So I'd just like to wrap up by once again thanking the Schuyler County Young Democrats for hosting this. Thank you very much. You're extraordinary. And thank all of you for joining me and helping me win this race. It's going to be a long race. I've been running for almost a year now. Trying to build support, gauging support, raising money. It takes a lot of money to run a campaign like this. We have to pay Neil, we have to pay Joe, we have to make sure that everybody can get out there to every single corner of the district. But you're all there, and we're gonna win together in November. We're gonna all get in there for the next 6 months, work as hard as we can, and the wonderful thing is we're gonna win, and we're gonna make a difference, and we're gonna make some change, and it's just gonna be awesome. So thank you all so much for being with me. I really appreciate it. And Stephanie, thank you to the Schuyler. Thank you.
And so I said, you know, a wrap up. As Leslie said, she has to pay us, the campaign has to pay us. And as the finance manager, I just want to ask you, I know a few of you have already made a donation tonight, but we are looking for everyone to make a donation if it is possible. I have actually brought my laptop, so you can make a donation right now tonight on the internet. And we're looking, so, you know, people people make different donations. People make large dollar donations, people make small dollar donations. One of the big things that the Bernie campaign has done, and you know, just like the Obama campaign and other grassroots campaigns, they really focus on the individual and how much the individual can give. And so we're looking for small dollar donations, but recurring donations. So you give $10 every month, $25 every month. It's not that much, you know. It's, you know, right now it's full tank of gas, which is not bad. And it's not that much to think about, but over the life of the campaign, it actually adds up. You know, if you make $25 donation recurring from now until the filing, that turns into $150. That's actually a good amount of money given to our campaign, and that's one thing. And then also, we can see what our projections are for the upcoming months. You know, it's one thing to give a donation now, but when we are working with the state power players, the you know, big unions, and you know, the people that can really give a lot of money, they want to know how much money we have in hand, but also how much money that we have that we can expect for us. So right now we're looking for small dollar donations, recurring donations. If you are interested, please, I will be by my laptop, and we would really appreciate your support in that way. So, thank you.
Is the state Democratic Committee helping?
Not yet. The state Democratic Committee will make some choices about which races to support, probably around June or July. And what they'll do is they'll look at how many individual donors we have in our district, how many volunteers, how many events we've had, and they'll gauge the strength of the campaign based on that. So, you know, what we're really trying to do is build that momentum. We're trying to be, you know, the Bernie campaign of upstate New York.
Yeah, so, I mean, we have one financial filing back in January, and our next financial filing isn't until July, which is a big, you know, span of time. But in between them, we've been really trying to garner a lot of small, you know, donor support, just because that is what the big power players are going to look at, the state setting is going to.
One of the things that was really cool about the financial filing in January, though, is that we announced with more money by four times as much money as any challenger to a sitting incumbent had ever announced with at that point in the race. In January, and it caused heads to swivel all across the state. You know, there were people all over the state who said, Southern Tier, where is that? Like, who is this that's running a campaign of this magnitude in the middle of nowhere? And I said, well, you know, it turns out it's not the middle of nowhere. We have a lot of people here who really care, who've been in North for a long time, and we're banding together and we're raising our voice. And people across the state are starting to notice, and that's really very exciting.
Well, I can vouch for that because having been at the Democratic Rural Caucus last week in Auburn, they introduced all the different Senate candidates that were challenging, and Leslie by far got the biggest applause. She had her supporters there.
Thank you. Well, that's really nice of you to say, Mike, but I really mean it when I say it's not me. It's because of all of you and all the conversations that we're having over and over. You can all know that this conversation that we're having right now, I get to go have it lots and lots of times with lots and lots of different groups of people. So you've got counterparts out there all over the place who are joining with you. Sometimes I want to just put all of you in my car and take you with me to the next event so that you can see how great it is that there's, you know, there's these other people in Dundee who are really excited, and there's people at Hammondsport and Bath, and there's people in Horseheads who are really excited, and I want you to just all meet each other and know what a movement we're building. It's you.
Well, that's the thing, that there were people from other counties there, and they all knew who you were.
Well, interesting, they passed out your sticker, one of your young ladies, and at the reception a little bit later, this woman comes up to me, she goes, okay, she goes, who the hell's Leslie? So I told her, and she went, well, she's not in my district, she said, I'll tell you, I would vote for her, because everybody in this whole place has her sticker on.
That's
it's
nice.
Pretty impressive.
Thank you.
Pretty impressive. You did a beautiful job.
Thank you very much. It's really a team effort.